Hi, this is Doug Parkinson, celebrating 20 years of Retrospectives with John Broughton on 3SER KC Radio.
Started at what point in your life growing up did you discover that you had this voice?
I don't know. It's always been a it's always been a bit of an issue with me. I've never thought I had one until a long way down the track. I was sort of like a late bloomer in terms of I loved listening to the radio and rock and roll when I was a kid, and like a lot of other people I know, I was fortunate. My parents always had a radio on or a record playing from the on the radiogram. But it wasn't until I remember I asked my parents to buy me a guitar for Christmas, and I think I was about 14, and I fiddled around with that for a little while. But it wasn't until probably the last year in high school I finished high school and started going into these talent quests and things that I really thought, well, I really enjoy this, and I'll see what happens if I pursue it a bit harder.
One thing I didn't know about you till I started preparing for this was your time as a journalist. Tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah. Well, that's right. Well, Mum and Dad made me. Well, they didn't make me, but they sort of said, "Look, at least finish high school. We want you to go to university and you know, get a real job, and of course have a real career." And I flirted with all that, and I thought I'll have a look at, I'd like to be a lawyer or a doctor, all the stuff that kids do. But by the time that my last year in high school had come around, I'd basically had enough. And I just got a series of menial jobs to get some money coming in, digging ditches and working on building sites and things. And then my mother said, "Well, look, you have a sort of a flair for writing, so the written word, so how would you feel about I've arranged an interview with the Daily Telegraph as a copy boy." I said, "Well, yes, that sounds good." So I went along for my interview, became a copy boy, and about 6 months later, I sat for an exam and began a cadetship in journalism, which lasted for about, I got through 3 years of it, and I really enjoyed it, loved it. It was exciting and fun, and met a lot of colourful people. But at the same time, John, this other part of my life was rearing its ugly head, and while all this was going on, I'd formed my first little garage band with the Barnes kids, and then moved on to another band, and by then it was getting pretty serious. It looked like I was sort of, you know, going somewhere with that. So I resigned from the Daily Telegraph and nearly caused my parents premature heart attacks and things. But it turned out to be the right decision. But I enjoyed my time on the newspaper. It was a very interesting place to work.
You got to interview George Harrison during that time. Do you have any memories of that?
Yeah, I did. It was... you know what it's like with cadets. I don't know whether they even call them cadets anymore, but with junior reporters, when you're doing your time until you come out and get graded as a proper journalist, you get sent on all sorts of horrible jobs, flower shows, dog shows. You know, you get up at dawn and you meet whatever overseas liner is coming in the harbour, and you get on a little boat and you bob out and meet the ship and then get interviews and council meetings and all sort of dry stuff that's not interesting for like an 18 or 19-year-old. You want a bit more excitement. So one day I had been assigned to do a flower show or a dog show, and a mate of mine called Kevin Killey, we were both cadets there, the Beatles were due to arrive in Sydney, at Sydney Airport, Mascot Airport, and we quite courageously decided to cut the assignment. And we headed out to the airport, and I flashed my press pass, and lo and behold, I got into the into the press part of the airport where the Beatles were sitting, my heroes, and I got a few quotes from George Harrison, who had said that the facilities at the airport weren't all that good. If you recall that when the Beatles arrived, it was a hideous day with the weather, and all the umbrellas were blown inside out.
Yeah.
And it was just a little cast-off comment that they could have had a bit of a undercover shelter to get from the aircraft to the terminal. But of course, they were such hot news at the time, that got me about four paragraphs on the front page. George Harrison says they should upgrade Sydney Airport. And instead of, I didn't get a byline, but I made the front page. And instead of getting a kick in the backside from the chief of staff, I thought the sword of Damocles was going to fall on me because I'd done the wrong thing. He actually said to me, now I'm very impressed you've shown initiative, and that's what reporters should have. So it was just very funny.
Now, there wouldn't be too many performers in the music industry that can claim a legendary cricketer as a major influence on their career, but tell us a bit about Sid Barnes and the impact he had on you.
Yeah, it's funny, isn't it? It's just funny the way things turn out. It's just, Mum and Dad moved to the beachside suburb of Collaroy when I was about the age of five, and I basically grew up on the beach out here, and I ended up back here. I'm back at Collaroy. I love it. It's just where I grew up. One of the neighbours down the road was a kid called Sid Barnes Jr., son of Sid Barnes, the legendary cricketer who played back in the era of Don Bradman and all those sort of people. And Sid Senior, I called him Mr. Barnes in those days because he was a pretty terrifying prospect. He wasn't very tall or very big. He was that fantastic stocky stature that I think, anyway, that real good cricketers have. They're littler men, but very muscular and very athletic, just ready, just a fantastic batsman. I mean, his record stands for itself. Mm. But he was a very imposing character and very short with his words and a bit terrifying for a young bloke. But that was Sid Jr.'s dad, and he was quite wealthy. He had finished his career by this stage and had become a sort of a property developer in the area. And they lived in a very nice home on Collaroy Beach, and he was considered quite wealthy. And he had bought Sid Jr. a drum kit, and his sister Helen a bass, and that was our first little band that we formed together because we all knew each other from the beach, and we would rehearse in their rumpus room at the house. They were so wealthy they had a rumpus room in the house. And we would rehearse there. That was my very first band called Strings and Things. But Mr. Barnes was—he didn't muck around. And I was quite fearful of him because, as I say, he had this sort of a grouchy demeanour. But it wasn't really. I just know that was just his way. He didn't. He had a large economy of words. He didn't speak much. When he did, it was, listen or look out. But there was a lovely side to him too, and he. Once he'd realised that the kids were serious about this band, he sent us off to the conservatorium for 2 weeks, and we had 2 weeks of lessons with a very famous old opera singer whose name escapes me now, Professor somebody, and we had 2 weeks of learning how to breathe and how to project, and I think just that generosity, just that 2 weeks in my life, it just made such an impact on me. All those years of slogging when I did the touring and the 10 shows a week and never having bad throats, that was all due to the fact that we'd been taught how to sing properly, and that was Mr. Barnes, that was Sid that did me that favour.
Those early bands of your Strings and Things and the Questions, were they pretty much representative of the music that was inspiring you at the time?
yes, the first one, Strings and Things, was very... Oh God! When I hear stuff back, we only recorded one track. It's just too horrible to contemplate, and it was just awful. But everyone's got to start somewhere, and I stayed with Strings and Things for a while until I heard a band down the road playing. We had a residency at a pub, that's what it was, and we were playing at night, and I had the newspaper job as well. But I went down and listened to another band called The Questions at the Manly Pacific Hotel down the road. And they worked 5 nights a week, and they were totally professional, and they were a pretty awesome hot band. And I thought, well, look, I really want to. And they didn't have a singer, John, and they all sort of made do with themselves. And I thought, now, I really want to join this band. So I went into a talent quest so they could hear me sing. And I came second to this gorgeous Chinese girl with a miniskirt and these white boots that went all the way up to you know where. And she sang "These Boots Are Made for Walking" and won, because every bloke in the lounge, of course, thought she was the Ants Pants. And I came second. And after that, after I'd finished my song, the guitarist Billy Green took me back to his home, and he said, "Look, I've written a few songs. Would you like to come and sing on them?" And I did, and I sang a couple of Billy's songs. And within, I think, 3 weeks, they'd made me an offer, and they said, "Look, would you like to join the band?" And that's really when the ball started rolling for me.
With the questions, you're on the support bill for that controversial tour by The Who and the Small Faces. Were you a witness to any of the goings on that tour?
Well, I actually instigated that. That was a silly thing. Can you imagine? I'd just come out of the Strings and Things knowing nothing, into the questions, learning. And Billy Green and Duncan McGuire teaching, these were my mentors. And I really learned everything on the job. That was the most incredible experience for me. And then within a very short space of time, here I was, support act to The Who and the Small Faces and Paul Jones. And it was just quite staggering. And I'd sort of gone from digging ditches to appearing with The Who within the space of about 18 months. It was all quite too much for me.
Yeah.
But we did the tour, and we finished up in Adelaide. We had a big party the night before, and I had a couple of bottles of beer that I'd left over from the party, and I carried them onto the plane, and the air crew were very, very frightened, because long hair and loud, you know, noisy sort of blokes. And the trolley went past with the tea and coffee and drinks and went right past us. They just deliberately didn't want to serve us. So I cracked up in a bottle of one of these warm beers. God knows why I did. The next thing I know, Keith Moon's wobbled down the aisle and said, "Excuse me, mate, he's got another one of those." So I popped that one too, and then we started drinking the beer, and of course, we got a little bit more boisterous, and then the captain came down. All of these poor old ladies at the front started moaning and groaning and in fear of their lives, and the captain came down and said, "Now, you lot sit here. Sit. Do not get up out of your chairs until we hit Melbourne." And made us stay there, and I looked out the window when we landed, and there's a line of Commonwealth police stretching from the bloody plane to the airport terminal, and we were basically held at the airport and almost arrested and weren't allowed to continue the journey. When I look back, there was no threat to the safety of the flight or the passengers. It was just a bit of boisterous hijinks. But in those days, if you can imagine, anyone with long hair was looked upon with, you know, fear and loathing.
Mm.
And the damn thing made the front page the next day. It was just an incredible blow-up out of nothing. But yes, something I'll never forget.
With the questions evolving into what became Doug Parkinson's In Focus, were you comfortable at that time in having your name billed ahead of the band in that way?
Well, I wasn't really. I wanted to keep the name The Questions, but of course I couldn't, because the drummer, Bill Fleming, owned the name. So we were scratching around thinking of a name, and a fellow called Harry Widmar, who was sort of like a impresario-type bloke, retired. He was sort of a quasi-manager, and he approached us and said, "Look, you boys, that was the first time I'd heard the pitch. I'll take care of all the problems. All you boys have to do is play. I'll take care of everything else." I mean, I've heard that about a million times in my life, but that was the first time. And Harry was actually the one who came up with the In Focus name, which then became Doug Parkinson In Focus, because by then I'd started to carve out a little bit of a reputation. It was lovely. I mean, back at the hotel with the questions before we broke up, it was wonderful. Saturday afternoons, I remember Billy Thorpe arriving with two boxer dogs on leashes and a gorgeous model on his arm. I said to the drummer, Bill Fleming, "Who's that?" He said, "That's Billy Thorpe." I said, "Oh, And he said, and that's called an entrance. And that's the first showbiz lesson I ever had. But we used to have wonderful Max Merritt come down, and used to come down, and Glenn Shike I met there, first of all, and Diane Lee, Ricky May, all those sort of people of that sort of vintage used to come and listen to us. But I wasn't comfortable with Doug Parkinson in focus because it really was a group, and I wanted it to remain that way. But that's the way the coin landed, and I suppose luckily that's how it all evolved just out of that.
In Focus left behind a string of wonderful singles, but never actually went in and recorded a full-length album. Is that a regret to you now?
Very much so, John. It was. We were just so damn busy. I mean, we were doing 10 shows a week. I mean, we upped and moved from Sydney down to Melbourne, had a couple of drummers till we found Johnny Dick, the final one. And that was the band, and this was sort of a lovely evolution. We were playing music. A lot of the groups, most of the groups, were products. They were dressed up in clothing, and the image thing was very, very big in those days. Our band and Max Merritt were the only ones, and possibly Thorpe, he came on a bit later with his second revival in his life, his career. They were really only the bands that were making sort of music, and I know I've left a few out, Barry McCaskill's band. There were a couple, they were sort of musical bands where you would play a song and then improvise with the solos, and it was very much the era of psychedelia and hippiedom and all that sort of stuff. And so our band was one of the few sort of musical groups, but we were working so damned hard, I swear, 10 shows a week in Melbourne we had to move. That was where all the music was coming from in those days. We were just too busy to actually take time out to record. And I know it's no excuse, but yes, we had some wonderful nights with that band that I deeply regret the fact that we never captured that and put that on record.
Yeah. Do you remember how the arrangement for Dear Prudence came together?
Well, we basically stuck to the same format as the Beatles, but how it came about was that a friend of ours, a chap called Lee Dillow, who was in England managing Kevin Boych, who was to be my future brother-in-law. We married sisters. The La-Di-Das, Kevin's band at the time, were in England, and Lee was managing them, looking after them. He came back to Australia with the White album under his arm about 2 weeks before it was released in Australia. They didn't have simultaneous releases in those days like they do now. So we actually got to listen to this beautiful thing before anybody else did in the whole country, including radio. And that track just stood out for me, and we'd learnt the song, started playing it live, and it started to go over so well, we just raced out and recorded it. So it was basically the same format as theirs, but with our sort of slowed down, sort of heavier feel, and my sort of rough old voice on it. It made it sound a lot different from the original.
I believe it was actually rejected initially by Festival before EMI took it on, is that right?
Well, that was weird. I mean, sorry, John. Yes, we had recorded with Festival a string of things that hadn't really emerged. I think we'd had one sort of decent hit out of the whole batch of them, a thing called Sally Go and the Roses, which was, I later found out, was produced by Phil Spector. But that's another story. And we had a minor hit with that only in New South Wales. So Festival, we hadn't really delivered the goods with Festival. And when we presented Dear Prudence to them, they passed. They said, we don't think that's going to be a saleable sort of commodity. So our then manager, Michael Browning, who later managed Thorpe and AC/DC and other people, Michael then took it straight to EMI, and a wonderful chap called Cliff Baxter, who was an icon in the business, loved it. So we were lucky. We got a release from Festival, and the next day was signed to EMI, and it was released. Thank God.
Yeah, absolutely. Now, a prestigious award back in those days was the Holy's Battle of the Sounds, which you shared with the Masters Apprentices 1 year, but I read there was a bit of a story behind what happened to your share of the prize money.
Well, yes, that's a two-pronged question. Firstly, we didn't share it, we won.
Huh.
They gave them they gave them a token prize because they'd been in it for 3 or 4 years, and people who had control of that competition felt that they deserved, because of their perseverance, they deserved to have some sort of recognition. Contrary to what Jim Keyes wrote and other people have said, that we didn't share that, we won it.
Okay.
And they were given that as a handout, if you will. Another thing I started to learn, how the business ran down there. But we, after all of that sort of prize money and stuff, and the trips and the, you know, the year's supply of Polly Waffles, all of that, which was very important to me, all of that stuff, I think the boys received, Billy and Duncan received two Maton guitars, and we got some amplifiers out of it. But the trip somehow got caught up in all the, not long after our manager, Michael, who had done the second, "Don't worry, boys, I'll look after you and I'll take care of it. You just play and I'll take care of all the finances." He had taken all our money and invested in an open-air festival in Melbourne called The Miracle at a place called Launching Place in Melbourne, which was going to be the very first sort of open-air festival. But he funded it with our money and our prize money and all the money we'd earned from doing the live performances. And of course, he didn't take out rain insurance, did he? And the thing just rained out for two days of the weekend that was on.
Mm.
And he scarpered with the dough, and we couldn't find him. He just got lost into the ether. And that's what happened to our prize money. That's when I really learned the hard lesson, which was never let anyone control your finances. And I never have ever since that day.
Not long after this, you headed off to England and joined the band Fanny Adams. Was it a difficult decision at the time to pack up and move over there at that stage?
It was, because I had I had formed an incredible... The whole band had become very much a little family, and we depended on each other, and you know, you never get close to someone until you work in a live environment with them, a performing environment. So we'd all become very close, but there'd always been a deep-seated, the bass player, Duncan. You know how important it is for a bass player to work with a drummer. It's everything, the rhythm section. If they're not happy with each other, it doesn't fire. So subsequently, some nights when Johnny would come in and play, he'd have something on his mind or a bit depressed, and the performances were down on... you know, the exceptional bloody level that it usually was. It got to the point where two hit records, you know, top of the tree, and Duncan, the bass player, turned around to me one night and said, "I can't work with this drummer anymore. It's either him or me." And of course, I was just absolutely floored. And I thought about this for a few days. And in the meantime, Johnny Dick had received an offer from England to form a band over there with Vince Maloney, who had worked with the Bee Gees, and Vince had some success and had set up and had a record contract with MCA. And it was basically, I suppose, a very selfish thing. It was an opportunity to go overseas. So I left my two friends, Billy and Duncan, here, and went with John to England, and we formed Fanny Adams there.
But
that was a disastrous thing, as it turned out.
You did have high hopes for that band, though, didn't you?
I did. It was the first time we'd actually had no pressure. We had time in the studio. We recorded in a beautiful studio called Morgan Studios in London, where people like Led Zeppelin and Sly and the Family Stone and, you know, a million other wonderful groups had recorded. And it was a wonderful thing to be in that high-flying sort of environment. So we basically, the band had an evolution of... We'd write the songs and then run in and record them, something I'd never done before. We'd always before, within Focus, we'd worked it live and worked out all the kinks live before we'd actually recorded anything. And then, so that was the system that I should have stuck to but didn't. Long story short, we recorded an album, but all the material, it was very heavy metal, very different from what In Focus was, and I thought, well, why not? I'll give this little sort of style of music a try. We recorded the album. We had a fantastic review in Cashbox in America. And we decided on that we were headed for America, actually, to do a tour. We had some dates lined up. And it was decided to call into Australia, do some work here, because the band had never worked live, you see, to do some dates in Australia, get the band nice and tight before we head over to America. But the tour ended up a disaster, and the critics were out with the knives, and it was just, it just did not catch with Australian audiences. And I think we were looked upon as, snooty smart asses, and because we came back with all this sort of English clothes and high boots and very loud amplifiers and things. And it was just a terrible mistake. And the band toured here, did some dates, and floundered and finally fell apart. Just in Australia, and we never did get to America.
Oh, shame. But the album, though, is something of a collector's item now, that Fanny Adams album. Is there any chance of a CD reissue at any stage?
I think there is a CD reissue. I saw somebody in Europe, I don't know whether they've bootlegged it or what they've done with it or whether they've got permission from MCA, but it has come out as a CD somewhere on some obscure European label.
Okay.
I have seen that. But, for what it was, I'm always proud of my work, but, so many ifs and buts, that's what life's about, isn't it? What if, all that kind of stuff. But I think if we'd had time to develop the thing a little bit more, and it just musically wasn't satisfying to me. It was just a bit of a misery going out there and working every night. And it's any performer, it's got to be fun. It's got to be enjoyable. It's going to be something to look forward to and be excited by and innovated and elevated by to perform. Otherwise, the whole thing is pointless to me. And that's what it became. It just became a drudgery more than anything. But there's some good moments on it. There are some good moments.
Is it true that due to contractual conditions, you were restricted from recording for a couple of years after that?
Yes, Vince had felt, and I suppose rightly so, that he'd spent all this money and all this time and invested his time and effort and put the thing together and organized things through his management, the contact in America and all that sort of stuff. And then he ended up with, the band's broken up now, tough luck. And he felt very disappointed and very angry, and as I say, rightly so. And When I approached him when the band had dissolved and said, look, I want to be released from my contract because I've got other plans. I want to stay back in Australia and put together another band and try to resurrect my career, my direction and my path. He said, no. He said, unless you come up with so many thousands of pounds, which he'd spent investing as an advance against royalties on the contract, which he was liable for because he ran the show. He said, unless you come up with that money and reimburse me, I won't release you. So for 2 years, basically, I wasn't allowed to record. I was persona non grata, and I wasn't allowed to record. And that, of course, left a gap where 2 years is a lifetime in rock music. You can't just be away and then expect to waltz back in and say, oh, here I am, I've just been on holidays, here I am again, let's go.
Yeah.
And that was a tough thing too. It's pretty depressing so far, my career, isn't it? A lot of lessons learned at John.
One thing you've made quite a career for yourself in recent times is stage musicals, but going way back, your first experience of that nature was the Australian production of Tommy. What are your memories of that?
Not very many. I think we did two performances with... It wasn't really a stage production in terms of a so-called legitimate theatre production. It was more a live concert with a huge cast. But it was wonderful. I mean, I loved that music. And Keith Moon came out and played Uncle Ernie. And another English fellow, I can't remember his name. I think he was Tommy. So we did two performances, one in Melbourne, one at Randwick Racecourse in Sydney. But that was fabulous and wonderful. But my memories of that are rather blurred. I was doing a lot of, drinking and drugging in those days. That's not the entire reason. I can't remember it all, but it is a long time ago. But you're right. All of a sudden a little light came on, and it wasn't long after that I'd moved into my first legit theatre piece, and all those theatre shows that I did from then on, which were sort of my early 20s into my sort of mid, well, actually, up until just a couple of years ago,
yeah.
It was another river to row down, and it sort of sustained me in a period of time where I was no longer a pop star, if I could use that word, into the sort of age, that older age, of the male performer, where you're no longer the headline news or the not in my case the pretty boy, but the young ingenue into a more serious sort of career with long-term prospects. And that's what had happened. That penny had dropped to me, because that's what I'd realized then, that I loved this job, and I'd realized that I was a good singer, and I wanted this to be my life, because it was important to me. But at that stage, things were looking pretty grim, and if all those theatre shows hadn't come along, I probably would have floundered and dropped off the tree.
You've surrounded yourself with some wonderful musicians over the years. What do you look for in musicians to make them people that you'd want to work with?
Well, isn't it funny? I spoke to Wendy Stapleton in Melbourne a few weeks ago, and she's a mate of mine, and she's a wonderful girl and a great performer, and she said the same thing. She said, "God, Parko," she said, you've always been so lucky. You've always played with good players." Well, you see, it's not a snob thing, a snobbery thing, or an elitist thing. I can't fly unless I've got the wings. And if I'm working with people who inspire me and empower me and energize me, I'm disappointed with myself. That's why I've always sought people who, stick their boot up my backside. It's a wonderful thing. It just takes you to another place. If you're sitting in a beautiful big armchair behind you, it just takes you to a place that it's like a parallel bloody universe. And I didn't realize this until just a couple of years recently, that how important it is to me. It's absolutely crucial to me, because unless you're working with like-minded human beings with a common cause and a common destination and pursuit, the whole thing really is quite pointless, I reckon. Mm. But in terms of lucky, yes, I have worked with a lot of great players, and it's been wonderful, because musicians and entertainers, they know a lot of other musicians and entertainers, but they have very few real friends. It's a weird thing. You might meet and play and love somebody in, say, 1 year, say, let's say 1979, and you might not see that person again until 1993. It's a funny coming and going type thing. But there's always that connection and that link, and that person's like a brother or a sister, because you've shared such a personal and emotional thing.
You had a little bit of time in the promotion side of the music industry back there in the 70s. Was that an advantage to you later on in your career, conducting your own career, having that exposure to the business side of things?
It was, John, and to tell you the truth, if you talk about luck, that was a lucky thing for me, because at that particular stage, it was all over for me. The In Focus had broken up, and I'd gone solo for a while, and I'd gone out there with a bunch of charts under my arms, musical arrangements, and played with a lot of bad bands in a lot of bad hotel rooms. And it got me to the point where I almost felt like, you know, necking myself. It was just so depressing because I didn't have that camaraderie with I've been so used to working with friends in a band. And I was at probably one of my lowest points of my life. And I had a young family. My first son had been born, and I didn't know what to do. I was yesterday's news. I fell and couldn't get arrested. And I just didn't know what to do. And then a friend who I'd met had said he worked for a record company, and I knew that one of the promotion guys were leaving for somebody who was moving on somewhere else. And I very, very graciously and generously, Paul Turner from Warner Brothers Records gave me a job as a promotion guy. And the next almost 2 years, it was very exciting for me. I learned how the business ran from the other side of the world, how radio worked. And of course, if you've got to remember that in those days, there wasn't a sort of global village, the world as it is now. Things were done different ways. It was mostly done through radio, and this was even before promotional clips were just starting to come into vogue. But I learned how a record label worked, how, you know, from, you know, creating the product and then promoting it and selling it, even through retail, the whole process. It was just fascinating to me, and I am lucky. I did waste a couple of years of my life, but boy, did I learn some good things.
I believe there was a bit of a controversy there in the 70s when you provided your voice to some advertising jingles for political parties.
Yeah. Well, they got it wrong, John. See, I was supplementing my my income by doing some advertising jingles and things, and because I was quick and I was accurate and I could, you know, I could record three harmonies in one take each, and they loved all that because it's all saving the money in the studio.
Yeah.
In fact, we did a Coca-Cola commercial which won an international prize in somewhere,
right,
in America or somewhere. But yes, one day I did someone from the Liberal Party, I think it was, in South Australia, whoever the agency was, they said, look, would you be up for this? I said, sure, it's a job. I'll do it. What's your price? Blah, blah, blah. So I sang their jingle, and that was fine. And then, weirdly, a couple of months later, got a call from another agency. Another bloke said, look, there's the Victorian Labor Party are doing a jingle. It must have been election times or something. Would you be up for doing it? I said, sure, it's a job. I'll do it. Here's my price. So all of a sudden, I've got one for the Liberal Party in South Australia, one for the Labor mob in Victoria. And for some reason, they all got upset.
Yeah.
Look, I mean, I was a hired gun.
Yeah.
It didn't matter where my political opinions lay. It was a job. And I at the time, I honestly, I know I was naive, but I couldn't see what all the fuss was about.
Yeah, well, I still can't.
No, I still can't. No, I can't. Yeah. Well, I mean, they didn't say, this is Doug Parkinson singing for the Labor Party, or this is Doug Parkinson singing for the Libs. It was just a voice on that commercial in the background,
yeah,
behind the voiceover. And I just honestly could not work out what all the bloody kerfuffle was about.
just the same, that became quite a good field of work for you in the 80s, didn't it, the jingle work?
It did. I did a lot of stuff, and it was interesting. Look, John, you've got to... I think I discovered early in the piece that because Australia is such a small marketplace in terms of population and all that sort of stuff, it's very hard to sustain a long career here. You've got to be able to do a lot of stuff. And I've always said this, and I still believe this, Australia is the hardest school of entertainment in the world. I don't care what anyone else says, because you've got to have very many strings to your bow. And that's what I mean. I'm talking about a person who wants to have a 30, 40-year career. You've got to learn all that stuff, and you've got to be able to deliver. And I learned that early on in the piece, and I'm not ashamed of that.
Do you think all the years in musical theatre has influenced or changed the way you present yourself in a concert situation now?
Oh, yeah. a lot of it sort of rubbed off there. I mean, you're aware of, you know, where the lights are. And I mean, as soon as you hit the stage, you're kind of looking at where the spotlight is, where the lights are, where the sound man is. You know, you become aware of the total surround sound environment, if you will. The theatre thing is a great thing because you've got to deliver every night, 8 shows a week, every night. You've got to be on. You know what I mean? On. You've got to be firing. And that's your responsibility, because so many other people depend on you to be that one part of that beautiful big jigsaw. But I find a lot of theatre, there's a lot of bullshit in theatre, excuse me, and or BS in the theatre, which doesn't really become applicable to getting out there and doing a gig that's a rock thing or a rock performance or a live performance, because all this hello darling crap I find very tedious and very I find a lot of it very two-faced. There's a lot of politics going on in the background, which there is in the rock business as well, but you've got to learn to just you just got to watch for the tsunami coming with all that stuff. You know, you got to try to prepare yourself. But I find a lot of it is very false and very manufactured and prepackaged in the theatre. But having said that, I've had some of my most wonderful, fond, favourite times on a theatre stage. It's been a beautiful thing. And it's quite magical and mystical what they do, and I'll never stop saying yes if a part comes up and I'm suitable and I think it's a worthwhile thing. I'll never say no. It's a lovely place to be. Mm-hmm. And not only that, John, just an afterthought, it's wonderful. Every Thursday they drop a check in your bank account. Like, people talk about job security when I hear it on the radio and maybe a talk back show. I don't laugh, but I kind of smile and I think, well, I've never known what that means. In my business, there's no such thing.
Yeah.
And when I hear people complain and whinge and gripe about it, I think, well, okay, it's time you grew up and joined the world. So every Thursday they put a check in your account, which is wonderful. Every Monday or Tuesday when you walk into the theater, all your costumes are cleaned and dry cleaned, hanging up in your dressing room. All of that is lovely. And You sort of start another family. It's very, and I've made so many lovely friends in the theatre. So they're all the positives. I still love it very much.
And just before I let you go, Doug, you're working on a new album at the moment, I believe. What can you tell me about it?
I've got three on the boil.
Three?
Yeah, I've got. this is what I want to do now. I feel I've been dragging the chain, John, and the clock is ticking. I've got three projects on the board. One is a live album that I did a tour last year through Queensland, and we did, I think we did 11 dates, five of which were theatres, and a friend of mine brought away his motorhome with an OB van. We recorded five performances live, which I'm in the middle of fixing up now. That'll be coming out the middle of March, end of March. My next album after that will be a jazz album. There's some beautiful things I want to do that with some special friends that I want to stretch myself on. And then at the end of the year, I want to bring out a big, loud, powerful sort of R&B rock thing. So I've got three projects on the drawing board. The first one's I'm about halfway through that. I'm gathering songs, and I've done some demos for the jazz one. And the third one, I'm just gathering material. So I've got plenty to do, but I've got my own studio set up here at home now, and it's wonderful. My friends, we get an idea or whatever, that my keyboard player, my MD, might send me over a keyboard part via email. I might send him over a vocal by email, and then we fine-tune from there. And I'm just loving this beautiful new technology. It's wonderful. I wish it had happened. I wish it had been around 40 years ago, John.
Yeah, well, it sounds like you're going to make the most of it now, which is fantastic.
And so getting at the time, the hours of the day, but as long as my beautiful darling wife can stay married to me with all this, having me stuck up in the studio all day, I'll be okay.
Hey, Doug, thanks so much for your time. It's just been a treat to catch up with you.
Pleasure, John. Thanks very much.
And thank you for all that wonderful music over the years, and sounds like a lot to come in 2009.
I hope so. You're lovely. Thanks very much, John.
Hope to see you down in Melbourne again soon.
Me too.
Okay, all the best.
Thanks, mate. See ya.
Cheers.
You too, John.
Bye.